thank you very much, Dr. Shah, for the invitation, for giving a talk and then giving you a little bit of information about what we have been doing on this one. So I'm going to talk about the new invasive exotic and ambrosia beetle, which is harboring a bunch of different fungi and creating the beetle, the plants that causing a bunch of branch dieback and tree death in Southern California. So with this work, I have been collaborating with the, as you can see, different group of researchers, Shannon Lynch, who is working in the Center for Conservation Biology department in UC Davis, UC Riverside, sorry. Paul Rackman Jones and Richard Stahlhammer are entomologists from the Department of Entomology in UC Riverside. Tom Coleman is the entomologist from the Forest Service, and Kim Corella is from CAL FIRE. She's helping us on monitoring and survey on this aspect. So a little bit background about the problem that we have been working on that. This ambrosia beetle is first detected in California in 2003 on one of the CDFA's the funnel traps in Los Angeles. At that time, it wasn't associated with the plant because it was in the trap. So there was no correlation between the cause of the branch dieback on the cause of the problem on the plant at that time. Later on, in 2012, it was found that the causing the death, the large number of the box elder trees in Long Beach City in California. So that was the another indication that something is going on with this ambrosia beetle. I just want to point out that between the 2010 and 2011, there are a lot of years, probably the population built up over the time and then start showing some problems. So in 2012, we found this one on a backyard avocado trees and causing a bunch of branch dieback and almost tree death in Los Angeles. That was like the first time we were able to recognize that the ambrosia beetle, it's carrying the more than one fungi and causing the death of the trees. So when we found this problem in 2012, we didn't know that much about the host range of the beetle and fungus that they are carrying. At that time, we only found it on avocado, a couple of the box elder and maple trees. That was all at that time. So we also didn't know that much information about the distribution of this beetle in the urban wildland and agricultural landscape, because we found this beetle at that time on one agricultural crop, which is avocado, and also we found there was several different sycamore and maple. That was all. But what we knew about this beetle at that time, this beetle was the close related species to the T-shot hole borer, which is a Eulalia fornicatus, which is an ambrosia beetle, which is the very important pest for the tea plantation in Southeast Asia at that time. So that was the only information that we know that we knew that that species of the T-shot hole borer has wide host range. So that was the indication that the beetle that we are dealing in California may have that wide host range. So when we first found this beetle, the beetle was morphologically identified as T-shot hole borer, as I mentioned. So this is the beetle. It is an ambrosia beetle. It's very small, black in color, and 2.5 millimeter size. Later on, the molecular studies showed that this beetle is actually not exactly the same as the T-shot hole borer. It's a little bit different, and But the difference is not obvious on the morphology, which cannot be identified and then given the new scientific name. So we decided to call it as a polyphagous shuttle borer because of the wide host range. So it still needs to be described as a new species, which is right now we are calling it Eulaceae species. So this is the female version of it. This is the male, which is smaller and a little bit light brown color than the female, which is 1.5 millimeter size. The male doesn't have the structure that they can carry the fungus, and they are flightless. They didn't develop their flight wings. They just walk around and then do the mating in the galleries that I'm going to talk about it. So that's all. So this is the size comparison of the beetle on a panel. The one on the left is the male. The one on the right is the female. A little bit background on the beetle. So this is a different life stage of the beetle. This is an adult, is moving and then making the bore into the wood tissue, as you can see here. So these are the eggs and larvae and a different stage of the beetle. So again, most of the information are coming from the T, the close related species of the T shuttle borer that we know, and also some of the research that has been done by the Dr. Starthammer from the UC Riverside. The sex ratio of the offspring is female biased, which means female or mother can determine number of the female or male in the galleries by fertilizing the egg or not fertilizing the egg. So they are able to keep the sperm from the male in a special organ, and then they decide which one needs to be female or male. This is an amazing control that they have. So brothers mate with the sisters in the galleries. Because of that, there is no known sex pheromones that can be utilized to trap or control or do anything else. So they do the sibling mating in the galleries. That makes very challenging for us to come up with something. So mated females leave the galleries and then create their own galleries. So as you can imagine, when the new generation are adults, they just comes out and already pregnant, mated with the siblings, and they are carrying their fungus, and then they are ready to make their own show. They usually stay in the same host, unless the host is completely dead. So they stay in the same host. That's a very interesting pattern that they have. So female can fly. The distance of the flight that we still don't know. There are a lot of studies, and then the information that we know from the T-shuttle borer is that they can fly up to 1 or 1.5 kilometers, which is about 1 mile or less than a mile, without the wind or any help of any outsides. And then they usually stay, the male usually stay in the galleries, and occasionally they come out, walk around, and then look for the opportunistic mating beetles outside of the plants. Okay. So, like other ambrosia beetles, this ambrosia beetle also has a symbiotic relationship with the fungi. This particular one, the female can carry, can have, or female has that. A special structure that they can hold and carry their fungal spores, which is called the mycangia. So this is like the two chambers they are located in their mouth part. Depends on the ambrosia beetle, those mycangia can be located in the different part of the head. In this case, it's located in their mouth part. As you can see, a lot of spores, those are the spores of the fungi that they are carrying, that I'm going to talk about. In this case, male is innocent. It doesn't have that structure that they carry any fungus. So they only feed on the fungus. So the reason that they are carrying those fungus, I'm going to talk about, they feed on the fungus. That's their food source. Okay? When we first start working and then on this bit of fungus complex that we found in 2012, so only Fusarium Wallacea was associated with this beetle. That was the only species that was known. In the meantime, this problem was also found in Israel in 2009. It has been causing damage on the avocados as well. Okay. So later on, we also found and looked into the those mycangia and then found the two other the fungal species are also associated with this beetle, which are the new species of the Graphium and new species of Acrimonium. I forgot to mention that the Fusarium Wallacea is also a new species of the Fusarium that was only associated with this beetle. So it doesn't, like, I get the question many times that if this beetle when came to the new land and then found and then another fungus and then start carrying. No, when the beetle was however it came to the United States, it came with the fungus that they are carrying. Okay, so these three fungi are the new species that we just found out. So this is the results from the co-postal list. Of course, when we found out that these fungi are associated with this beetle, we had to prove that if they are pathogen or not. So co-postulates is the pathogenicity test. As in the plant pathology discipline, when you isolated, recovered a fungus or more than one fungus from the symptomatic tissue, you have to complete the co-postulates, which is the pathogenicity test. Unless you finish the dose trial pathogenicity test, all the fungi is being recovered from the symptomatic tissue are innocent. They are not guilty yet. So unless you complete the pathogenicity test and then find out that those fungi are causing lesion and symptoms on the healthy tissues, that means they are the pathogen. So these are showing the results. We completed this the study on the avocado and box elder trees, healthy seedlings, we inoculated them. Those fungi artificially, Fusarium Wallacea, Graphium, Acrimonium. We found out that those three of the fungi are pathogen on two of the healthy seedlings. So the fungi are pathogen to the plants, but they are not pathogen to the insect, beetle. They have a symbiotic relationship. So how does this symbiotic relationship works when it comes into the infection? So the beetle, as you can see, this is the one of the infested the wood tissue, like the you can see. So this is the beetle gallery. When the beetle is start boring into the plant, it just goes through the bark and branch out, as you can see in the wood tissue. Okay? In the meantime, they inoculate the fungus on the wall of the beetle galleries, as you can see, and then start continue growing those fungi on the surface of the gallery. So these are the white structures, all the conidia of the spores that was introduced to the plant. They feed on that fungus. That's the only food source. They don't feed on the wood pieces at all. They only can make the galleries to make home and also to introduce the fungus to grow the fungus. That's why in the heavily infestation we only see the toothpick kind of the frasses coming out because they don't consume any wood tissues. In the meantime, the fungus continue colonizing, as you can see here, the discoloration in the plant because they are pathogen on the plant. The plants usually respond when they have the attack from the any pathogen. In this case, when they get the attack by the fungus, they usually, as a response, they produce the tylosis and gumming on the xylem vessels to prevent the movement of the fungus. But most of the time, they don't notice that is causing the choking on the plant and making the branch dieback. And also sometimes it's the complete tree death, as you can see on the box out there, right here. Okay? So I'm going to look at the current distribution of the infestation that since we have been doing that the survey since 2012 using the one of the computer-based device that we can enter all the data. And we have been looking for the, like the street and everything. And identification is the visual based on the symptom, because each host shows a different symptom. When you look at these symptoms or inside, sometimes you may not find the beetle in those symptomatic tissues. But what you find is that the fungus, when they are not successful, then the host is not suitable or reproductive host, they always inoculate the fungus on that case. So what we do is that we look at the symptom, we peel the bark, look at the entry hole, which is our first indication, and take the sample from the dead discolored area, bring it to the lab, and analyze it based on the morphology and also DNA-based identification and identify based on the fungus, because we know that the dead fungus is only associated with the beetle. So these are like the preliminary results. As you can see, until now, we observed more than 2,003 species, and 48% of them found to be infested or get somehow attacked. So avocado is number one, big leaf maple, cassipin also get hit by the disc beetle, California sycamore, box elder, coastal elm. So this number can increase more way. So this is the current distribution of the infestation since 2012. So in 2012, when we find out this beetle was a problem, that was the infested area. In 2013, this was the infested. 2014, that's how much. So beginning of 2014, we also found another infestation down in San Diego and El Cajon. It looked like the polyphagous shuttle borer. At first, we thought that this is the extended infestation of the infestation from the Los Angeles and Orange County area. But our molecular study showed that this is actually another species of the Euallaceae, which is the close related to polyphagous shuttle borer. We still keep the name as the same polyphagous shuttle borer. Okay, so unfortunately, this beetle is also carrying the different Fusarium species with it. So I'm not going to talk about that different invasion right now, but just mentioning that we have another invasion species in the San Diego. So, and also that infestation expanded to the Escondido and the other part of the San Diego area. So it was also reported in one of the CDFA tribes in Santa Cruz area that was identified as a polyphagous shuttle borer. As a morphology, we still don't know whether this is the extent of the infestation or the leaf infestation over here. So we haven't gotten that sample yet to the molecular analysis. Okay, just a brief information that the Quercus robur, 100 years old tree, that was the symbol of the Huntington Botanical Garden, and that was attacked by the disc beetle and fungus, and then it was gone. I'm just gonna talk about like the very brief, one more minute. We did the host range study. In that host range study, we utilized two heavily infested arboretum, which is Huntington Botanical Gardens and Los Angeles Arboretum in Los Angeles County. So in 2012, during our survey, we found out that the beetle attacked 285 tree species in 2012. So 117 of them were infested by the fungus, 13 of them were agricultural crops, 11 of them were the native tree species, this is the 62 different families, and 19 of them were the reproductive host. This number became increased in 2014 in tremendous amounts. So 13 agricultural crops, California native plants, including the California box elder, coastal oak, California sycamore, big leaf maple. and you can find all those information. Actually, this information is published in Plant Disease in 2013. So, and also we have like the 34 reproductive hosts that means that the beetle can reproduce on the 34 of the those species as well. Okay. So with this, I'm done. What I have to talk, and then if you have questions, I will be happy to answer.